All right, guys, thank you for listening to the Spike Paranormal Podcast. I am your host, Shane Pittman, and our co-host, Brandon Gamble, is off for tonight. So he will be joining us next week, and we may even do a show this weekend, just depending on what goes on. Maybe a special treat for you. But speaking of special treats, I have just that for you tonight. We have a very special guest on the show, and he is the, I guess you would say, the owner of enclosedworld.com. He pretty much runs that website. He has been letting out on YouTube and various other things flat earth clues, different clues that he's been putting out, and people have not been able to give adequate answers to these things that he's been suggesting. So without further ado, guys, I want to welcome Mr. Mark Sargent to the show. How are you doing, Mark?
I am doing well. Thank you for having me, and I'm happy to be here.
Well, thank you very much for spending the time to talk to us a little bit. But sure. I wanted to get right into this and ask you a little bit about what made you start looking at this theory, looking at this to begin with. I mean, a lot of people would not even touch it. Me personally, I'm very skeptical of it. I've told you that before we started the show. But yeah. What got you started into it to begin with? What made you say, hey, I want to look at this?
Sheer boredom. That's really what got me into it. I was a conspiracy guy for years and years and years. I mean, not tinfoil hat Mel Gibson from conspiracy movie guy. But I was into it pretty deep, and I had looked at just about every conspiracy five times over. And this one, everyone who is into conspiracies, everyone who has ever had doubts about the government and, you know, corporations and lawyers and politicians, you know, everyone knows about this conspiracy. We've all heard of it, but it is so silly, and it's pushed to the back of our minds, and we never ever look at it, and you got to wonder why. So, especially in recent events, if anyone has been living under a rock for the last couple of weeks, if the whole Kyrie Irving thing that happened in the National Basketball Association, if you want to know where he got it from our community. Did he mention my video specifically? No, but he didn't mention anybody's. So I was bored, and I looked at some YouTube videos that were just kind of hinting at it back in 2014, the middle of 2014. There wasn't a lot on it in 2014. What you're talking about now isn't the old flat earth society. This is a whole new animal with new arguments and new debates, and it's come out of not necessarily nowhere, but it's really come with a lot of fire and fury. But back in 2014, it wasn't there. So I was looking at it, thought I could shut it down. That was the big thing. Everybody, it's not like people wake up and they say flat earth is the greatest idea ever. Nobody thinks that. Everybody thinks it's a piece of crap. I did too. Honestly thought I could shut this thing down because I'm a great creative problem solver, especially if you give me enough time. That's what I was trained to do when I was doing my career, you know, between software testing and bug fixing and sales engineering. When it came to software, I was really good at creative workarounds, and I could not for the life of me nail flat earth down. I couldn't do it for whatever reason. It started, you know, looking at the flights in the southern hemisphere, then looking at Antarctica and looking at NASA and looking at the Van Allen belts and looking at no curve. And finally, in the beginning of 2015, I decided, you know what, there's only so much I can do. So I made a series of videos called Flat Earth Clues. Enclosedworld.com wasn't even built. And I just put the videos on YouTube and just kind of like put it out there to see if someone could help me out from the academic community and say, okay, you're wrong. Here's why. You can stop talking about Flat Earth now. And within less than 3 weeks, the opposite happened. A lot of people started contacting me, and it really started resonating with people because I made a series of clues. It was kind of like a shotgun pattern approach where I didn't use any math to speak of. I boiled it down to its real fundamental, the lowest common denominator points. And I connected some dots, and I said, look, if you look at this and this and this and this and this and this, you put them all together, they all seem to point towards the same thing. And it's that was that Sherlock Holmes thing. If you eliminate the impossible, whatever's left, however improbable, has to be the truth. And it kept pointing at the same thing, which was, at the very least, the world isn't a globe. And it went back to the old, there's some experiments done, the Michelson-Morley experiment, which you guys can look up, and the Aries failure. Aries failure, I think, is probably the most quotable part of the flat earth theory, which was he was looking for this ether that was supposedly flying through the solar system, and he couldn't find it. And it was interesting because his final synopsis was, either I've failed or the earth isn't moving. And it's called Aries failure because you go, well, we all know the earth is moving, obviously. So it's got to, I've obviously failed. So here's the question. I know you've got stuff, but I this is the thing I've got to start it off with, which is, anyone out there listening right now, how do you know you're on a globe right now? How do you know? Don't tell me what you've read. How do you know for sure? Were you willing to bet the farm on this? Because I was at one point. But the thing is, when it comes to everything else in physics, meaning like a fire burns, water is wet, drop something, it falls to the floor, it's either pushed or pulled, whatever. It's called gravity. There's some sort of force doing that. These are things you can test right now in your home right now. When it comes to the shape of the earth, this is something you're told. And eventually you're going to come back, and I'm filling in the blanks for some of the people that are out there, because I'm sure they're just banging on their computers or radios right now just going, holy smokes, this guy's insane. But no, bear with me. If you are – lost my train of thought for 1 second. If you think it's a globe, how do you think that? It is not – because eventually you're going to lean back on NASA and the space programs, right? And I'm going, okay, what happened before NASA, though? Because it's not like we woke up in 1972 when NASA released the only photo they ever claimed to have taken of the Earth in full sunlight. It's not like we woke up in 1972 and said, oh, it's a globe. We knew for 400 years beforehand. But how did we know? It's because science told you it was a globe. They put a globe in your classroom when you were 6 years old, and it sat there for 12 years. And that's why you're going berserk right now. That's why you're throwing things and thinking about chatting or calling into the show, if it is a call-in show, because of the conditioning that you had. You were told for so many years that it was a globe, between the education system and the science fiction movies and everything else. You just know. You firmly believe. I'll use a quote real quick, which is, the George Orwell, the famous writer of the book 1984, he wrote an article for the Tribune in 1946 when he said he's not a flat earther, but he said that he was talking about the responsibility of science. And he said, it's really interesting. He goes, you could go to the man on the street and ask them, how do you know you're on a globe right now? And they would say, well, we know. That is your reaction. Well, we know. It's a given, like algebra. We know it's a globe. And then you say, well, how do you know? The people start to get mad because your brain doesn't know how to react to it. And it's interesting because that article was written in 1946. NASA wasn't even founded until 1958. So how did everybody know in the 40s and the 30s and going all the way back that it was a globe? It's because you were told. And that's where your journey will start, because then I say, okay, fine, prove it's a globe. Prove it. Can you do it without using the word NASA? Can you? Are you going to use sticks and shadows? You're going to use star constellations? You're going to say Coriolis effect, stuff like that? Going to mention gravity?
Right. That's what I was going to bring up next. What if somebody says, okay, well, what about what science tells us about, different methods that you could use? Magnetic poles. I know some people bring that up. That the magnetic poles wouldn't work out right if the earth was flat. It has to be a globe type.
Oh no. Yeah. No, no. I got
for it to work. You know what I mean?
No, in fact, it's interesting that you mentioned that, because even the world's most famous astrophysicist / actor, Neil deGrasse Tyson, he'll be the first one to say on camera, and he's done it many times, where he said, look, science can only tell you what gravity does. It can't tell you what it is. It has to make massive assumptions. Science makes leaps of faith bigger than any religion, in my opinion.
Right.
When they say, well, what's gravity on a flat earth? I say, what's gravity on a globe? right now. The science had to come up with something. Science hates using question marks. So they're going to say, well, gravity is mass, and it's this invisible, mysterious, magical force that pulls everything towards the center of a sphere. All right, well, that's fine. On a flat Earth, gravity is a mysterious, magical force which just pulls things straight down. And the north, now, does that, now, magnetically, of course, you still have the north and south poles, except that the north pole on a flat Earth, because people are going to go, what the hell is a flat Earth model? A flat Earth is if you took a globe and you pancaked it, put your hand on the north pole and smashed it and to where it looked like a dinner plate. So when you say that the Earth is round, you can't say that. You know, no, the flat Earth is round. When globalists, it's either a globe or a sphere or a ball. But the magnetic north is still at the center of the plate or the pizza or whatever you want to call it, how the roulette table, whatever you want to define it as. And as far as the south magnetic pole goes, I had an Australian military officer last year tell me there is no magnetic south pole. It's an illusion. It's everything keeps pointing north. He goes, there is no point when you get to the south where the compass immediately flips over and goes to a magnetic south pole, which I thought was very, very interesting.
That is very interesting. And I've told a lot of people this. And my idea of if the flat Earth theory is true, okay, yeah, that there is validity to this, then our definition of a lot of things that are scientific, the laws, the theories, all of it changes. Because
very much so.
Right.
Which leads into the question. I know we're going to bounce around a little bit because probably 1 in 10 people will ask me, why does it matter? Why would they hide it? Why would you hide if the Earth was a globe, a snow globe, or a Truman show, or a sports stadium, or a terrarium, planetarium, whatever you want to call it, because it's really all of those things.
Right.
I'm saying, are you kidding? Here, the big problem is that after the initial shock wears off, people would say, well, who made this place? Because, and again, I'm not saying it's the handprint of God, but a lot of people would interpret it as that. It's either an advanced civilization or, you know, something more divine. But yeah, you're talking about the physical sciences? Oh, the upheaval. Astrophysics and astronomy. Gone overnight. The remaining sciences, and take your pick, geology, hydrology, biology, archaeology, to name a few. Anything with an ology on the end of it would have to be rewritten from the ground up. And speaking of which, here's a leap of faith that people say, well, you know, science wouldn't lie. Science doesn't believe, you know, they have most of the questions answered. I'm going, oh, really? I go, you ever look in a science book and look at the cross-section of the Earth? It's supposedly 4,000 miles to the center of the Earth and 8,000 miles across, roughly. And they will show you exactly what it's made out of. You know, it goes from red to orange to yellow to a white spinning molten center, right? And I'm going, wow, that's really great. How'd you figure that out? How deep did your probes go? 1,000 miles? No. 100? 10? The deepest hole ever drilled is 8 miles. But they will show you the exact composition of everything going down through this imaginary sphere that they've created. And not only that, but they'll show you, and you're going, well, they've got seismic radar, ground penetrating radar. I'm going, well, those things were, the books were made a long time ago. It's not, you know, and not only did they do that, even if you could make me believe that they could look inside our planet, they'll give you cross sections of every planet. Venus and Mars and Jupiter and every planet there is. It's like, how are you doing? There's planets you haven't even claimed you've landed on yet. Where are you coming up with these things? So I'm saying that, I put this to a scientist the other day. I said, so why, if you have not been deeper than 8 miles, why don't you just show the children's textbooks with a big question mark in the center? And that's because science doesn't like question marks. They don't like people asking questions. So even though they'll say, well, you know, we don't really know, they don't put that disclaimer on every page, so everybody assumes whatever science tells you is truth. Neil deGrasse Tyson's line, science is right whether you believe in it or not. I think it's one of the most arrogant statements ever made by a scientist ever, but he said it multiple times.
Yeah, I've heard him say it himself. My question is this, and a lot of people would ask this as well.
Sure.
That, okay, if the Earth is flat, then yeah, why do we see a round moon, a round sun, the planets that we could see with a telescope from here?
I got you.
Right.
I got you. VM, because we were supposed to believe it was a sphere. It is part of the illusion. And I talked about this in the clues. I can do this in two parts. One is because you got to remember, we did not make this place. Human beings had nothing to do with the design of the world you live in right now.
Right.
Eventually, whoever made this place had to create the illusion that the world was a sphere. And the reasoning behind it was that human beings are the only life forms on this world that do not like confinement. Every other life form, you can put them in a wildlife preserve, they'll act perfectly naturally, especially if the preserve is big enough. And that goes all the way into the primates. But human beings, you could have the most beautiful, again, if they found out they were in a snow globe, you know, a giant Truman show. Look what happened to Truman. What in the Truman Show from the movie. Once he found out, even though he lived perfectly content throughout his, you know, into his 30s, once he found out, that was it. All he cared about was getting the edge, and his first chance he got, he was gone. That's all anyone would care about. But when it comes to the illusion, that's not hard. Again, if you go to we'll just pick the Neil deGrasse Tyson one. If you go to the Hayden Planetarium, you look up at the moon, they can show you anything they want up there. A crescent, waxing, waning, you know, the blood moons. How does a blood moon happen if there's no Earth between the sun and the moon? It's all part of the display system. It is all, the sky is just a clock system / display system in Mandelbrot resolution. That's all it is. And it can display anything it wants.
So do you think that solar eclipses, lunar eclipses, all of these are just like holograms or something that is being displayed to us to kind of keep us from knowing the truth?
Yeah. Because and again, you know, people say, what are the sun and the moon? I'm going, the sun and the moon are, well, the sun isn't 93 million miles away and the moon isn't 237,000 miles away. Are they two-dimensional or three-dimensional objects? Jury's kind of out on that one because we don't know the technology that's being used. What's interesting, though, is the coincidences that occur between the sun and the moon. And I know we have limited time, so I'll rattle them off real quick.
Okay.
You note that the moon fits perfectly in front of the sun during a solar eclipse, right?
Right.
And they say that, well, the moon is 400 times narrower than the sun, but it's also 400 times closer than the sun. Great coincidence. Love that one. Throw in the other one, two more coincidences. One's a coincidence. One is not. That the moon, the face, the side of the moon you see is exactly perfectly the only side of the moon you see, meaning it is locked in to where it only shows us one side of the moon, meaning... And you're thinking, well, that's not a big deal. I'm going, you know how statistically impossible that is? That it's locked in gravity-wise to where it only sees one side? Meaning, over hundreds of years, it doesn't even turn 5 degrees to where we see the backside of the moon. That's the second one. The third one, if you want to look up something really interesting, look up why the moonlight is cold. And people say, well, I mean, we all know it's colder at night. I'm going, no. Meaning the moonlight is actually some sort of refrigerant. It's a refrigerating light. So the example I'll give is everyone knows that if it's 90 degrees in the sun, it's 80 degrees in the shade, right? Because the shade is blocking some of the sunlight. You go into the moonlight, and you can test this right now with a point-and-click $20 thermometer from Home Depot. You go to the moonlight, it may be 60 degrees in the moonlight, but if you go into the moon shade, it's actually warmer, up to 13 degrees. In some cases, that's impossible. That cannot happen.
Meaning, why do you think that is? You think it's because it's just a hologram or something?
Because it's its own light source. It's self-illuminated. For whatever reason, it's generating. We can duplicate this now in technology. We've only been able to do it for, I don't know, 10, 20 years, which is a cold laser. You can generate lasers that will cool things. But the question is, why is the moon doing that? And you're saying, that doesn't prove a flat Earth. It's like, no, that doesn't prove a flat Earth. But it certainly wipes out any relationship between the sun and the moon, because the sun should be reflecting off the moon and some of those rays should be getting down to Earth. At the very least, you should get no temperature difference between the moonlight and the moonshade. But in this case, if you're in moonlight, it's actually colder. And I don't know if you call it decrepifying or whatever it is. But science hasn't addressed this, and I don't know why. And only because the technology has recently become available to all civilians, anybody can go out and test this. It helps, you know, if the moon is directly overhead, you know, if it's low on the horizon, you're not going to get much of an effect. But I've seen it myself. Oh, and then I will take credit for this, even though I didn't discover this or the first part about the moonlight being cold. I was one of the first people to suggest. I said, you know, if you take a magnifying glass to sunlight, you can burn stuff. What happens if you take a magnifying glass to moonlight? You know what happens? It gets colder. Which means it is. It's a cool laser light. And I don't know how to explain it other than, it again, does it prove a flat Earth? No, it doesn't. But it absolutely changes the entire relationship between the sun and the moon. Science will never be able to convince me that that's what's supposed to happen when the sunlight hits the moon. Oh, also, one more thing. When you're looking up the moon, notice how freaking bright white it is. It's extremely bright. You know, the moon is very, very bright. It looks like it's self-illuminated. And yet when you see all the Apollo footage, they're walking around a really dull, gray, ashen surface. You'd think that glowing feeling would be down on the moon at the same time. But no, it's always this dark, dark gray. Well, what the heck were we seeing when we look up in the sky? But that's a whole other thing. Anyway, sorry.
Yeah, and also I've heard about the phenomenon called the lunar wave that Crow 777 actually...
Oh, yeah.
He had on his YouTube channel, and it's amazing. Can you let us know a little bit about the lunar wave, what you know about it, and how this correlates with everything?
Well, the lunar wave has kind of evolved over the last year, which was Crow 777, you know, and he was the first, he fairly big channel, and he told people, it's like, look, flat Earth is a piece of crap, right? But he did record something that didn't make any sense, which was a lunar wave. It looked like one of two things. Now, initially, because I was in the video game industry for years, I thought it was a resolution issue, meaning it looked like the moon was being refreshed. It looked like one of those vertical hold things from the old television days where there was this band of resolution, like it rippled through the entire moon, like you were looking at a refresh rate issue, if you know anything about computers.
Right,
And he thought that too. He's going, look, there's something wrong with the moon. That's all this guy did, was take a telescope and shoot, you know, great images of the moon. And then later he comes back and he's going, wait a minute. Because then I knew in the background he was looking at the firmament idea and the fact that if we are in a snow globe, what is the dome made out of? Is it a heavy element? Is it a heavy water? And because the biblical thing, the firmament separating the waters above and the waters below. And he's going, wait a minute. Is that a refresh issue or is it a ripple? Is it like a ripple through fluid? He goes, is the moon actually encased in some sort of liquid? Because that's what, you know, when you're looking at it again, it's a toss up. What are you looking at? Is it a technology issue or is it a physical issue? And yeah, it's amazing. But yeah, you want to have some fun, go to Crow 777 or just look up Lunar Wave on YouTube. You'll find it in 2 seconds.
Yeah, it's amazing. Whenever I discovered it, and discovered his channel, it's just amazing some of the things that he has captured and has found. But Mark, yeah. I wanted to ask you something. I've heard you say in a podcast before that you absolutely believe that UFOs are real. How do UFOs play into all of this? Because if we are in some sort of enclosed world, then what are these things? What are these UFOs? And are we seeing them from the outside of this enclosed world, or are they here with us?
Excellent question, because I don't know anymore. I do think I know what they're not, or at least I think they're not. And I don't think they're from Mars and Jupiter and Venus and the solar system that was initially described to us. I think they are just older versions of us, meaning we are not the first... If this world isn't closed, if we are living in a giant Truman Show, it's not a one-off where, you know, we're not the first people to rent this apartment, which means, and that makes sense because we have huge gaps in our history. We all know that. The sunken cities off Japan, the sunken cities off India, how old the pyramids really are. You go on and on about, you know, how far back civilization, you know, was Atlantis real? Was there a continent of Mu? What happened? You know, how many versions are we in? Are we version 7? When it was back in like version 2, did the continent of the supercontinent Pangaea, was that what was happening back then?
So
Pangaea, by the way.
Oh, I'm sorry. I didn't mean to cut you off. So are you saying that do you believe somewhat the hollow earth theory, you know, about the ancient civilizations and all of that? You think that that has something to do with this phenomenon? What's going on?
I do. That's how I got started on this, was I was a big hollow earth fan. And that's when I was looking into this, when I was looking up the world's greatest modern explorer, Admiral Richard Byrd, when he was looking, you know, everyone knows him from the hollow earth theory, that he supposedly flew in a rickety plane in 1926 and, you know, did that journey to the center of the earth thing through the North Pole. But what was interesting was they retasked him and put him on the South Pole for the next 30 years up until his death in 1957. So do I think there's other civilizations down there? Yes, I do. Do I think that they are previous versions of us? Yes, I still do. And when it comes to UFOs, when you're looking at them, don't think of them as like Martians and Venusians and Saturn people and all these other things. I think when a civilization reaches a certain technology or a certain amount of time has elapsed, that civilization then has to move into the next phase and make way for another civilization. And if you survive the change or the transition, whoever survives, they are not allowed to interact with us on a mass scale, you know, because one of the oldest UFO arguments is, well, why haven't they landed in Main Street? I'm going, are you kidding? Have you not watched Star Trek? You know, the prime directive is a real thing. You can't land anywhere and take pictures and sign autographs and shake a few hands and leave. You would permanently affect that region. You would start entire new religions. I will use the, again, because I know we've got to abbreviate some of this stuff. You want to know the greatest UFO sighting you've probably never, ever heard of? Forget about Roswell or 1899 Aurora, Texas, or any of the other crap. Look up 1561 Nuremberg. It is the greatest UFO sighting of all time. Right over downtown Nuremberg, Germany, in the spring. Don't tell me it was snow dogs, sun dogs, where... two huge factions, two space armadas, flying aircraft carriers, launched fighters and duked it out for a full hour over the city. And you're to the point where, remember, they didn't have cameras back then, where people were eating their toast and schnitzelgluben, and there were sketch artists that came out and drew the whole thing out. They said, holy smokes, this is incredible. And I mean, there's a great wiki entry on it. And after an hour, here's where it got really weird. After an hour, a third faction showed up, a single giant black angular ship parked itself right between the two of them. The two factions took off. And it was interesting because even Ancient Aliens, the show on the History Channel, talked about it, but they left out that part because that part makes it way more interesting and way more real, because then it opens up, oh, I don't know, 10 more questions like, okay, who were the two factions? Why were they fighting in the first place? Who was the third faction? Where is the power hierarchy? Are you not supposed to fight over the city? Why did it take them a full hour to get there? What sort of response time is that? Are they the cops? Are they the UN? Blah, blah, blah. It goes on and on. But the point was, it actually happened. And it's out there. You can look at the newspaper, the sketch that they did in full color in a woodcut. It's gorgeous. And it shows all three factions in a bright, sunny day, no clouds. It's amazing. So the question is, what I believe anyway, is that every civilization that goes through this place where you're in, again, planetarium, terrarium, whatever you want to call it, they've got to follow some rules. And after your civilization has its time here, wherever you go, whether it's a subterranean thing or outside the dome or whatever, I think there's protocols in place where you are not allowed, you're not supposed to break the rules. You're supposed to let the civilization develop naturally. And up until now, that's exactly what's happened. But it seems to be breaking down this year. I don't know why.
Well, Mark, why do you think that we have been deceived for so long? Who do you think is behind all of this? Who do you think is trying to keep all of this a secret?
I think it's a combination of things. So I think the original project, the original building of this place, we were supposed to figure it out naturally. I think every civilization is supposed to figure it out naturally. Remember, for the first, well, you know, if our civilization goes unbroken, our history goes unbroken for about 5,000 years, for the first 4,500 of it, we weren't going to find it, because the outer edge is way out there, and the upper edge is you need some serious technology to do it. So for the most part, the system, whoever designed the system, designed it for us, I think, to find it eventually. And really, up until very recently, in history terms, meaning until you have the internal combustion engine, you're never going to detect this place. You can, you know, the globe model would have stayed without the internal combustion engine. Globe model would have stayed forever, kind of like the Truman Show. Until there were problems with production in the Truman Show, he was never going to find out. He would have lived a full life and never known. So when if you follow the flat Earth timeline, and I don't know how much you want to go into it, but you can ask questions. When the United States government figured it out, and the Russians figured, or the Soviet Union figured it out in roughly 1956. They were the ones, they didn't have to do much to keep it a secret. That's all they were doing. So this isn't your standard conspiracy where, you know, there's a lot of evil plotting, you know, like JFK or 9/11 or Pearl Harbor or any of that stuff. This is an existing secret that you're keeping a secret. So all they had to do really was spend money and gently, well, as gently as they could anyway, keep people away from places they weren't going to go naturally anyway. Not, I mean, nobody goes to Antarctica on a regular basis.
Yeah, what does Antarctica have to do with all of this?
Well, if it is a snow globe, if it is an enclosed system, then there's an outer edge. You know, if it's a sports stadium, again, that's why you have to create the globe model, because if it's a globe model, if you tell people it's a globe model, they're not going to look for the edge. But if there is an edge, then that edge, where is it exactly? Well, it's all around you. And which means there's got to there's an outer marker, not necessarily the end of the world, but it's a border. And that border would be the continent of Antarctica. And what I mean is, no matter which way you go, if you ignore the GPS system and compasses, if you can go in a straight line, no matter which way you go, you're going to end up in Antarctica. Antarctica is a massive continent that is all around you. It is the outer rim. And what I mean by keeping it secret is in 1954, Antarctica was being swarmed by all these countries because they found all these resources on it. Admiral Byrd went on television. You can look it up, where he talked about how there's a mountain range made of coal, and there's minerals, uranium, and oil, and all this stuff, and people maybe even be fighting over it. And then Murphy's Law, you know, he finds the outer marker, and they decided at that point, well, we can't take a chance that some corporation is going to figure this out with a plane that gets lost, or a helicopter, or a snowmobile team, or whoever it is. You know, even the snowmobile team would be a far, far stretch. And so they put in the Antarctic Treaty in 1959, and they said no corporation anywhere in the world can do work in Antarctica. Period. End of story. Nobody goes there. And we're talking all countries sign this. How? There is no other treaty in our civilization that is unilaterally signed by everyone. China, Russia, Korea, take your pick. Nobody goes down there. Nobody even argues it. You'd think that a country, if they were running low on resources, would fight for this. They're not even allowed to talk about it. So if you're, and we all know this is a bunch of crap. This is what raised a lot of eyebrows when I made the clues, because we all know, especially in the United States, if you want to start fracking in your backyard right now, they can do it. It's not hard. All they have to do is bribe the right people or bribe you or whatever it is. If they want to frack, they can. But they're not. If I'm the head of Exxon, you know, let's say Exxon Mobil, right, I'm not even allowed to talk about it. So I can't. You know, if it was me, I'd call up my buddy at the New York Times. I'd run full page ads every month, say how great it would be for us to go down to Antarctica. That never happens. Nobody ever even talks about it. And the world is run on greed and money and power. And that it goes against everything that we are as a species, as much as I hate to say it, but it's true. No corporation, what treaty is beyond, is unbreakable? What treaty is beyond money? What secret is beyond money? And I completely understood it when I saw it. It's like, of course, because you can't. Once you get, if you let an oil company, I'll just pick on the oil companies. If you let an oil company down there, eventually, sooner or later, they're going to keep encroaching. They're going to keep working back and working back and working back. And sooner or later, you're going to have to say, okay, you can't go past this point. And they're going to say, why? And you're going to say, well, national security. And then it's like, okay, why? And, you know, sooner or later, somebody's going to, you just don't want to deal with it. It's too much of a hassle. So they said, you know what? Screw the money. we're just not going to let anybody go. It's a no-go zone for anybody, and that's it. And the treaty's not even up for debate until 2041. And they'll cite, you know, environmental things. Now it's like, really? Millions of square miles of nothing but ice, no indigenous plant or animal life? Really? That millions of square miles of ice, and you're gonna claim it for scientific research? Bunch of crap.
Well, you know what I find really interesting about all of this is there are some flat earthers out there that actually disagree with some of the things that you say the time. Why do you think that there is? Why is there that distinction? Why are some people at odds when it comes
there are
to this?
A couple reasons. One, there's two big camps that are going on out there. The big camp is, okay, is it enclosed or not enclosed? Which kind of leads into the biblical versus non-biblical version of a flat earth. So if you follow the whole biblical side, and I don't care what religion you're following, whether it be, you know, Buddhism, Judaism, Islam, Christianity, or Hinduism, you're gonna, you know, that most of them talk about some sort of canopy, some sort of dome, a firmament. But there's other people that say, well, there's no firmament, and they would be in the minority. But that it's an infinite plane that goes on forever and ever. And I'm saying, well, no, there still may be land out there, but I'm saying that we can't get out. And when, you know, if there is we are inside a structure, then you got to ask yourself, okay, was it built to keep us in? Are we like a box? Are we a box of kittens to be taken care of? Or are we a box of scorpions that you really don't want to get out? Because there's a lot of sci-fi movies that, you know, going all the way back to the 50s, say human beings should never be allowed to explore on their own, because we do awful, awful things. The other side of the dissension in the ranks is because we don't have, science is really reluctant to deal with this head on. They don't have a lot of ammunition against it in terms of arguments. So we're kind of like this big army that's just getting restless outside of the city. We don't know what to do. So we start, you know, we've turned against each other in some cases, not seriously, but, you know, we're sparring quite a bit because we debates are few and far between. It is tough to find people in the scientific community that are willing to put their necks out there, because you don't want to be here. Here's the thing. And this is a challenge to science. If anyone's listening out there, you don't want, because science should be able to shoot this thing down in 2 seconds. So in a debate, if you're a scientist going up against this, if it's not a complete slam dunk win on science's part, it's a loss. If it's a draw, science has lost. If you waver in the slightest, science has lost. And they don't, you know, who's going to be that guy? Are you going to be that guy that's going to, you know, stand up to, you know, if you don't have all the answers, that's why. So initially they'll take shots, say, no, gravity and the sticks and shadows and all this other crap. But then there's a lot of questions that we throw out there that they can't answer. And then they stop. And so then they don't debate us. I mean, in fact, I was invited to a debate April 1st, I think, on a show. And they have a really, really tough time of finding a scientist. In fact, the last one, I was supposed to get a scientist on a fairly major radio show. And the best they could get me was Stanton Friedman, the world's greatest UFO researcher. And he tried to walk his way through it, and I felt bad for him, but, yeah, not much I could do.
Now, have you had anybody say, Mark, I have this information that completely shoots it down? Have you had anybody say, I have some interesting ideas, and did you look at that information that they gave you and said, they have a good point, this could prove otherwise? Or
to date, in fact just the opposite. When I started doing this, because I was waiting for somebody, look, if somebody gives me convincing evidence of any kind that we are absolutely dead wrong, I will look at it, and I'll quit flat earth. But what happened was I started getting subject matter experts from different professions that, I mean, again, unsolicited, they just started calling me, Army, Navy, Air Force, Marines, structural engineers, pilots, air traffic controllers, you name it, they were coming forward, and they were all saying the same thing, which was, we think that your idea has got some real merit, here's why, and they just started adding to it. And then once I developed a base of, I don't know, 20 of these guys from all different walks of life, haven't gotten NASA yet, big surprise there. But I was waiting for other people to come out against them. You would think, especially with the military, you know, come out anonymously. And I would challenge them. Look, somebody wants to come against this Navy missile instructor who was in 10 years that says, you know, not only are we is there no curve that we can see, I'm painting targets at 60 miles away with a beam radar, which I shouldn't be able to point to point. But the Coriolis effect isn't in the firing solutions. And the artillery guys saying we're not using Coriolis effect in the firing solutions. And the torpedo guys and the tank guys and the pilots all say that all the pilots all say the same thing, which is when we're up there, we see an absolutely flat horizon. But it's a paradox because we're told it's a globe. So their logic is, well, if we get from point A to point B in our plane and nobody crashes and we get our job done, we're just not going to worry about it right now. Because if you're a pilot, even if you believed it, you can't tell anybody. Because you'd be benched, you'd be grounded in 2 seconds. Right. And which is why I joked. I said, you'd be better off telling people you were chased by a UFO than to tell them the Earth was flat. At least people believe that.
Well, tell us about the plane routes a little bit. That's really interesting and really strange to me.
The plane routes started out as a kind of a side tangent. I was like, that was clue 7 when I got to it, and there was a guy from England, his name's Lawrence, who was reinforced. He kept pushing me to go down the plane routes, and I thought it was pretty good, which is, he goes, if you take any plane route, do a fake booking for a flight anywhere in the Southern Hemisphere, and that's from, you know, Africa to South America to Australia, anything below the equator, but it's got to be quite a ways below the equator, over water preferably. And he goes, try to book a nonstop flight. That's where it started. He goes, all the flights are going everywhere. And in fact, I had a professional travel agent that worked in the Southern Hemisphere. She was one of my subject matter experts. And she's going, yeah, people will complain to me all the time that you could not get a point to point. So if you're going from Buenos Aires to Sydney, Australia, why in the world are you going north? To places, why are you going through Los Angeles or Dallas or San Francisco? She's going, and all the pilots said the same thing. When it comes to airlines, it's all about the cost of fuel. They don't care about picking up passengers. All they care about is the cost of fuel. And 95% of the flights in the Southern Hemisphere, when you're going southern to southern, go north for no apparent reason whatsoever. There's just a handful, just a small handful of flights. And one of them, of course, which is why I made clue 9, because I said, guys, find me a freaking nonstop. And everyone kept pointing at like this one flight. They go, well, this disproves flat Earth because I found a nonstop flight. And it was Qantas Flight 64. I think it was Auckland to Santiago. And what's interesting, I was like, all right, fine. I will watch these flights. I will watch these handful of flights because you can go on to online and the DOD releases the info, at least what they say the GPS system is, where you can follow the flights because you can watch your loved one fly anywhere. And I started watching this one flight leave South America heading towards Africa, and it gets about 150, 200 miles off the beach, and it just vanishes. I was going, okay, you know, maybe I missed something. So I keep watching more and more flights, and they just keep blinking out. They keep blinking out. I was going, okay, what am I missing here? It's a global system. Why am I not seeing the flights? And in fact, when you go to the flight, even if you see the graphic, you go into the latitude and longitude, and latitude and longitude changes from numbers to the words approximated or estimated, which means they have no idea where the plane is. And I'm going, wait, that's impossible. That can't be because if it's a GPS system with 30 something satellites up there, the blanket coverage, you'll never lose a plane. But that's exactly what was happening. I was going, no, it's not. Either one of two things is happening. Either they're hiding the GPS coordinates because they don't want to show you the routes, because the routes would make absolutely no sense on a globe, and they only make sense on an azimuthal equidistant map. Or there's no satellites at all, meaning there is no coverage. And people were emailing me almost immediately after and said, maybe it's both. Maybe it is that because it's a ground-based system, before the GPS system was around, there was a system called LORAN, LORAN. That was, again, American DOD system. It was ground-based radar. What I think happened was when they got to the point where they had to fake everything, they just said, okay, we've got 30-something satellites up there. We've billed the taxpayers for an enormous amount of money. and we'll just put the GPS system, put that sticker on the old Loran system, and no one's going to know any different. Because who's going to watch planes in the southern hemisphere when they go over the water? Up until now, nobody did. Again, when the plane takes off and lands where it needs to be, then and everyone lives, then fine. Which is why that, remember those Malaysian flights that got dropped a few years back?
Right.
In the Indian Ocean? That was in part of the zones that wasn't covered. Because I was always wondering, I was like, wait, those are flagship planes. One of them was a 777, I was pretty sure. It's like, that's a flagship plane. How do you lose the most advanced commercial aircraft that was ever made? How do lose that plane?
That's a very good point.
Yeah, it wasn't tracked. It disappears. They're not there. In fact, you can even see that in the northern hemisphere if you can get to the if you leave from San Francisco to Hawaii, because there's no islands between San Francisco and Hawaii, you get far enough out, that plane disappears. That should not be. And it's fascinating, fascinating stuff. And that was one of the things that kind of got me in it. It makes you scratch your head. And you're saying, well, it doesn't prove a flat Earth. I go, well, yeah, here's where you have some fun. Plot out some of those connections when you're, you know, the double and triple connections from the southern hemisphere points, and then look at them on a flat map, a flat Earth map. They turn from these severe angles into these almost straight lines or shallow dog legs. And you're going, well, yeah, but it can't be literal, right? It's like, can't it? Can it be literal? I didn't think it was, but everything that I kept looking at kept pointing at the same thing, and that was, there's something wrong with the world. There's something wrong that they're not showing us. Let me throw one more in the mix real quick, because I you only have so much time, and that is, look up pictures of the Earth from space. There was literally only one picture, full picture of the Earth from space released by NASA from 1972 until the summer of 2015, when this thing started going, the whole flat Earth thing. That's 43 years. And we're talking every space program, every satellite, long range, short range, whatever you want to call it, nobody took a picture of the Earth for 43 years. And we know this for an absolute fact, because when they took the second one in 2015, the White House, Obama did a speech on it, Neil deGrasse Tyson tweeted it, and NASA tweeted it. And they said, oh, yeah, this is our second blue marble shot. And it's like, oh, it's no big deal. Just what are you talking about? 43 years? Nobody takes a picture of the Earth for 43 years? Statistically impossible.
You think they were releasing that, supposed second picture to, because they've been hearing all of these theories circulating about?
Yeah, absolutely they were. It was, again, it's the only conspiracy I know where the powers that be have been reacting to the questions that are being asked. And in fact, of course, it was too little too late. I call it the angry wife syndrome, where, husband comes home after 40 years and his wife says she's divorcing him. And he goes, why? Because in 40 years, you've only brought me one set of flowers. So what happens the next day? Well, he brings a thing of flowers home, and he goes, well, you don't have to divorce me anymore. And she goes, what are you talking about? The only reason you got it is because I mentioned something yesterday. That's that's what happened here. They released, literally in the same month, the summer of 2015, they released a picture of the Earth from space, a 20-frame moon transiting in front of the Earth from a satellite that was a million miles away that nobody had ever heard of. They released the Japanese footage of the Himawari satellite, which shows the Earth in full disk where the weather's morphing, but the Earth isn't rotating. By the way, that's also something that you'll never find right now. You can get pictures of the Earth rotating, but the weather isn't morphing, or you can get the picture of the Earth just sitting there with the weather morphing, but it's not rotating. You can't get both right now. And neither of these things existed before 2015. It was incredible, the amount of stuff that just wasn't there. And I'll throw one more, even though people hate this clue. You want to have some fun? Tell me why, if Hollywood releases, especially this year, this is the year of sequels. There's nothing but sequels this year, the entire year.
Right.
Hollywood, if there's a nickel to be made in Hollywood, they will make a movie on it. Tell me why there's never been a movie made about the Americans landing on the moon. Not one. Not a single one. You go, no, there's got to be. I was like, really? Because I'm a huge media junkie. Two movies only ever been made, even scratched the surface. One was The Right Stuff in 1980. Oh, crap. Was it 83 or 84? We'll say 83. And then Apollo 13, which didn't land on the moon. There has never been a moon movie, and not even straight to DVD. Never happened. Again, statistically impossible. for God's sakes, Paul Blart Mall Cop had a sequel. And you're telling me, in fact, The Right Stuff won Academy Awards, would have won Best Picture, but it lost to Gandhi. You know, everything was going to lose to Gandhi.
Yeah, of course.
And it was set up for a sequel. The movie was 3 hours long, made tons of money. No sequel, nothing, because they can't. You cannot let a film company, you cannot let a studio simulate the moon missions, because it will blur the lines and it'll get too close, especially for the studio. The studio will be shooting the movie going, hey, you know, this actually looks better than the real thing. And then all of a sudden someone going, hey, wait a minute.
So you think that it would be revealing that the original quote-unquote moon landing was faked?
Oh, yeah. You can't let people – you can't blur the lines too much to where people will look at it and say, you know – it's because they'll show them how easy. That's why I include the Rammstein video, We're All Living in America, in some of my background stuff. Because Rammstein, you know, a German band, they don't, you know, outside of the United States, there's a lot more people that don't believe in the Apollo program. And they just went to an empty warehouse and simulated the moon footage in their video. And it's damn convincing, even though it's just a rock video. The whole thing is pretty much shot on the moon, and it looks color-coded exactly like we did it. And they did it for, you know, pennies compared to what we spent.
Well, and it makes you wonder, if you can do something like that, then you would have to question everything. And I think that's why a lot of people, like you included, ask these questions, because you realize that there are so many things that the lines can get blurred. And there's so many things that can be altered and reproduced to a way to we won't know what's reality or not.
Very, very true. Look, there was a question I always wondered, because, again, a conspiracy guy. If you're a conspiracy guy, you know about the Apollo stuff.
Right.
But for me, it really bothered me that I couldn't come up with a good reason to fake the moon missions. It bothered me. It's like, okay, yeah, fine. America goes up there, wave the flag. We're the greatest, rah, rah, go team. I got that. It was a good reason, but it wasn't a great reason. Then I got this. Then I got into the whole, the Earth may not be a globe thing. And then it changed my thinking completely, which is okay. Then it got really scary. It's like, okay, they didn't want to fake the moon missions. They had to fake the moon missions. If you don't fake the moon missions, if you don't get up there, in fact, Matt Boylan from the NASA channel was really, I will say this, he really did nail this, which was, eventually you have to take the picture of the Earth. You've got to take a picture of it, but you can't just hand people pictures. You've got to fake a space program, at least give people the reason or how you took the picture in the first place. It's the most expensive picture of all time. You have to fake a rocket program, because otherwise people are going, how'd you get up there so high to take the picture? And the moon mission, this way you keep the private sector out of it for a long, long time. The big subcontractors that gave all the parts to NASA, you know, like General Dynamics or Lockheed Martin or Boeing, you've got to militarize space. And so you do the moon missions, you go there, and then you say in the 70s, it's like, well, the ratings are terrible and nobody cares about going to the moon anymore, so no one's going to go anymore. And that's where they left it. And that was it. And all the other countries didn't go either. People still, it's amazing they don't question why the Russians, why the space race didn't continue on the moon. Why'd the Russians quit? It's not like a marathon races. People finish the race. Doesn't matter who gets there first. People keep going, keep running. And this is like, oh, Americans got there. Russians, oh, yeah, we'll just pack it in. Just shut it down. Quit. Everybody just quit. And that was it. It was mind-boggling to me. Anyway,
and it wasn't just one person. It was everybody quit.
Everybody. The entire Russian space program stopped reaching for the moon, even though they were way ahead. And again, if you're in the conspiracies, you understand. It's like, yes, the Russians were good at faking it in the beginning, but then the film techniques caught up. And, you know, look into the Stanley Kubrick stuff, where he took him 5 years to make 2001 A Space Odyssey, which still, even in Blu-ray, has aged amazingly well. And you got to look at what he did, and you know, what studio? He was financed by the government to make 2001 A Space Odyssey. No studio is going to let some guy go for 5 years to build a movie and won, you know, Best Picture, and is an amazing So what they did was they said, okay, what can we do? How can we fake this in film? We'd like you to research it. And then he says, well, whatever research techniques, can I keep them and use them? It's like, fine, as long as you don't turn it into a documentary. 2001, A Space Odyssey, backs out at the last moment, you know, when the, you know, because Space 2001 was done in 1968 and the Apollo moon thing was done in 1969. And then, you know, later again, not to go off on a tangent, but then he releases, if people think I'm kidding, look up the documentary called Room 237, brilliant, where Stanley Kubrick, guilt-ridden, builds in his confession and codes it into the 1980 movie The Shining. That it was like, look, I did it. And the Room 237 is because 237 is 237,000 miles to the moon. The mystical room 237, where nothing is real. You go into the room and it seems like a beautiful dream, but it turns into a nightmare. Oh, it's a great documentary.
Wow, I definitely got to check that out. You still there?
I am.
All right, thought I lost you there for a second, but yeah, I definitely want to check that out. And to all the listeners out there, please check out the Room 237 and all of the other information that Mark has let us know about tonight. But, Mark, I have one final question for you.
Sure. Go.
And this is something that, you know, I ask a lot of people, whatever their ideas are. Mm-hmm. What is the one piece of proof that will convince you, okay, the flat earth is bogus? What does somebody have to present to you to make you drop it all and say, okay, we do live, we don't live on a flat earth, we live in a globe type scenario?
If somebody had to show me something right now, I think it'd be something that was outside of the clues, something basic that would because I wouldn't want it just for me, I'd want it for everybody.
Right.
Show me evidence of the curvature. Show me the evidence of the curvature, most notably forward and back, meaning if mainstream science says the curvature is roughly 8 inches per mile squared, why do we see things now? And again, it's the camera technology, it's really changed. Find me an object at a distance that no matter what we do, you know, it's usually less than 100 miles, that what no matter what we do, we can't see. And up until now, that's never happened.
Well, have you heard about the weather balloons? They send the weather balloons up, and apparently they saw curvature there.
Sure. Well, I mean, the Red Bull jump with Felix Baumgartner
showed
a severe curvature, but that was at 130,000 feet. But we've got plenty of standard weather balloons at 120,000, roughly, which is, you know, not much difference, which shows no curvature at all. Any weather balloon that you see with a severe curvature is using some sort of fisheye lens, otherwise known as a peephole lens. Okay. And when you look out your peephole in a door, your hallway is not curved, but the lens is going to show that it's curved. When you use just a standard lens, it's perfectly flat. And again, I don't blame people for, you know, again, people, I still get people to say, look, I've seen the curvature from the beach. I've seen a curvature from a plane. And I put the challenge out almost, 18 months ago now, where I said, okay, fine. You see the curvature, you take a picture of it, you put it on your laptop, you hold some sort of straight edge up to it, a piece of paper, a ruler, whatever. If you still see the curvature, well, I don't care if it's a video or a still shot, you email it to me, and if I buy it, then hey, you know what? I'll quit Flat Earth. I have yet to even get a submission along those lines.
See,
I've heard
of that blows my mind. That really blows my mind that if people are contesting what you're saying, that they would not try to debunk it by sending you a picture and letting you know, hey, I found it. Here it is for you. There you go. But nobody's done it yet. It's crazy.
That's just it. And again, I know we're running out of time. But let me say this. It's not because they don't see it. It's because they want to see it. Everybody wants to see the curve. Because you've had the globe in your classroom since you were 6 years old, you want to see the curve. It's almost like the Orwell thing, although I use the Star Trek Next Generation, where there's only four lights. But if they keep telling you there's five lights, eventually you're gonna start thinking there may be five lights. You want to see the curve because you're told it's a globe and there's got to be a curve. Got to be a curve. And that's where people say, no, I've seen it. I've seen it. Are you sure you saw it? Or did you just think you saw it? And your mind, you know, it's not that your mind was playing tricks on you. You were remembering your conditioning. That's all you were doing. So yeah, up until now, you know, nobody sent it to me, and I don't expect. Look, if it hasn't happened now, it's not going to happen.
Right.
So, but if it happens down the road, hey, great. You know, if somebody wants to try to put me up in space. Oh yeah, by the way, last parting shot, that SpaceX thing where they said they're going to go to the moon next year.
Right.
Oh, yeah, that's never, ever, ever. I can't believe they had the audacity to even make that claim. Because even NASA says, no, it's too expensive. We can't do it. And SpaceX is going, oh, yeah, we're going to go there next year with what, a booster that's never been tested, a capsule that's never been tested, and you're going to take amateurs, and it's never been even attempted in 50 years, even if you claim that's real? Come on. I might as well say that I'm going to finish my time machine next year. So,
well, Mark, it's been a very interesting conversation. I really appreciate you joining us on the show and letting us know your research. I mean, I think it's very important that we listen to all sides. Change is hard sometimes. Listening to other viewpoints is sometimes difficult, especially when you're used to an idea or you're used to certain things being a certain way. Whenever something is thrown into it that throws a kink into it, we get uncomfortable and we want to shrug it off. And I really appreciate you, the bravery of coming on the show. I mean, I know there's a lot of people that are just rolling their eyes, but just the bravery alone of letting us know what you found and, you know, just putting yourself out there like that. I really appreciate that.
Well, thank you. And again, don't take my word for it. Don't believe a single word I've said. Do your own research. Ask your own questions. Try to prove me wrong if you can. But I got to warn you in advance, anyone that goes down this road, you're not going to like this is the Planet of the Apes, end of the Planet of the Apes movie. You're not going to like what you find.
Well, and one thing I really like, too, is you make yourself readily available. I mean, you on your website, you give your email address, phone number. You have nothing to hide. It seems as if you're welcoming anybody to prove you wrong.
Oh yeah, yeah. My life story is I'm an open book. I mean, I've put everything out there. And again, if people want to try to tear me down character wise, I'd love to see it. So I didn't want to do this, guys. Did not ever think I'd be doing Flat Earth. If you would ask me 3 years ago, I would have said you're insane if you think I'm going to be doing the whole Flat Earth thing in 2017. But here we are.
Well, could you let our listeners know before we let you go, could you let them know where they can find you and where they can find your information and if they want to reach out to you, where do they need to go?
Okay, so the main website is enclosedworld.com. The phone number is 303-494-6631. The email address is msargent23@comcast.net. The easiest way to find me, though, again, all paths lead to the same place. Just go into any search engine or YouTube, but YouTube's probably the easiest. Just type in Flat Earth Clues, and you will find me. My YouTube channel is just Mark K. Sargent, and you'll have some fun with it. But be prepared, because at this point, there is a lot of videos out there by a lot of people. The community is monstrous, and the conference, you know, first ever Flat Earth, first time in 500 years, Flat Earth International Conference in North Carolina coming up in the fall.
Well, Mark, thank you very much again, and we hope to have you on the show again in the future to let us know any additional information that you may have found out. I hope you have a great night, man.
You too.
Thank you.
All right.
All right, guys, you have been listening to the Spike Paranormal Podcast, and that was Mr. Mark Sargent, and we will be right back on the Spike Paranormal Podcast.